Thanks very much, everyone, for coming today. Esperance is a pretty special region for me. Some of the really early adopters and passionate people in this area that took on the technology when it, I guess, like it was proven from a kill perspective, but from a functional perspective, you know, we had a long way to go. And those machines have been operating here and possibly with some headaches and you know, now we're really proud to present, I guess, our latest technology. Before, I just also wanted to say big shout out to Sam and his team for the testing that they did. That's the most comprehensive I've ever seen, and I've been testing mills for 14 years and I know what it takes to unpack all of those combination of factors. It's just, it's like, I don't know how many tons of chaff they process, but it would be like this room full of chaff probably, and the amount of weed seeds that they dealt with and all the counts and everything, it's just huge, monumental stuff. And I'm actually really inspired by the results because it's demonstrated some opportunities for us to get better, not only us, but the industry to get better and kill the weeds that are actually in the paddock, not just the ones that we're buying from seed growers, but the ones that are actually in the paddock. So I just probably just wanted to step back a second and talk about like why I do this. For me, I'm actually from Kangaroo Island, from a sheep and grain farm. And my first taste of harvest weed seed control, it's pseudo harvest weed seed control, was actually learning to drive the header. It was an old class Dominator, and Dad told me that I had to lift the cutter over the top of the ryegrass and just let the sheep eat it. Yes, we're not killing any weeds by doing that, except for the ones the sheep get, and hopefully they don't pass through the system. But it's just about not spreading those weeds, that just leaving them where the patch was, so we're not spreading the patch. And it's taken me a long time to figure out, I guess, why the head is so much of a problem. And Chris talked about the ones, you know, there's quite a few weeds that are shedding before harvest, or they're below the cut height, the brome grass that's bending down and flicking back up. But those weeds are staying where they grew. They're like mum and dad are dropping the seeds down at their feet, and they're all competing with each other, not getting spread. The ones that are going into the combine are getting spread up to 500 metres down the field. And the reason is, it's like a perfectly designed seed spreader. Goes in the front, you cut it off at the front, and maybe you're only getting 40%, but 40% of 200 seeds is still a lot of seeds, right? That's going into the thresher and separator. Ideally, you're getting it out of the head. It's falling onto the sieve, and we've got our sieve set up with airflow to separate the material that's lighter than the grain. So that lighter material, consequently, is a lot of our weed seeds, and they're going out the back. But there's still a bit of weight in those seeds. So we have this system where the sieve at the end has actually got a lower air velocity to allow heads that are unthreshed to go back through the tailings return system and get re-threshed. And what we find is that the weed seeds are actually going into that tailing system and actually doing multiple laps of the combine and slowly getting spread down the field. And I first really noticed this when I saw the first camera system on the John Deere return system. I was driving a machine up at Noanga up with a Terminator on it and drove through this patch, this non-wetting patch, it's full of ryegrass. And it took hundreds of metres before the tailing system didn't have ryegrass seeds in it. So that told me that ryegrass was just going around and around and around. Hopefully it goes into the grain bin. We had a Terminator on, so we were right. But those seeds are getting spread up and down the field. So we're getting a lot of weed patches getting spread by the combine, regardless of how much we're capturing at the front. So to me, that's the real motivation of why we think that no header on the planet should be spreading weeds anymore. And that's my mission and my team's mission to try and figure out how the hell we get every header on the planet stopping these seeds from being spread. This is just some really old research on wild oats, which sort of demonstrates what I'm saying, is because everyone would say that wild oats shed. And they do. They do shed their seeds. They also don't produce a lot of seeds. So what you do capture does make a difference to their population. So on the top left, we've got an image of a starting population. And hearing this, this is research from Canada, and here is what would happen over multiple seasons, changing the direction of harvest to those patches. So there's only a few patches. And you can just see that those patches are being spread, and then those patches then get spread, and over time you just get a much bigger area that's impacted by that population. And this bottom picture here, that he had a Steve Shirtliff is the researcher, he had a chaff cart, and you can see over multiple seasons those patches are moving a little bit, they are impacting the crop a little bit more than they were, but capturing those few that are actually getting into the combine causes the biggest impact on the total area infected by weeds and therefore the cost. So to me, yes, it's about getting as much in the front, but it's also about just stopping the spread of the ones that you do. And I guess, so just going back to my history in this space, I started a PhD in 2010, 14 years ago. And I was tasked to try and figure out how to get a mill to go onto a header. At that time, we had the Harrington seed destructor. The first prototype was on Ray Harrington's farm, which if you haven't seen it before, it's a trailer with an engine and a mill from a coal mine that they managed to get to work. And really where I actually started with a prototype, but after a year of not getting it to work, I actually went back to the fundamentals. And that was to look at how much you need to hit an annual ryegrass seed in order to kill it. So I had this rotating blade, which is this system here, with a bit of duct tape, as you do in research. And this is a frequency controller. So it's just a blade that had a roughly meter diameter and wind up the speed and literally drop seeds into the path of this blade. So the seeds would get a whack, and then I would basically put multiple seeds through this device and change the rotational speed, and I would change the number of times those seeds were impacted. So this plot here is impact speed, so the speed of that rotor. And this is percentage of ryegrass killed. And these lines represent the change in number of impacts. So we had one impact, two impacts, four impacts, eight impacts, 16 impacts. And I guess it's kind of intuitive that if you increase the speed, you're going to kill more seeds. And if you increase the number of times you hit it, you're going to increase the kill. And what I did was, I actually poached an equation from the mining industry that, well, the particle size reduction science, and they looked at, if you had multiple impacts of some products and like different plastics and also rocks, you could actually predict particle breakage. So I sort of combined what I found with some data from the mining and came up with this equation, which basically could tell me no matter how many impacts or impact speeds I had, I could predict basically the kill. So all of this data came onto this curve. And then what I did was model what was happening inside of a mill and using computational fluid dynamics to try and understand what was going on. So literally modeling the airflow and then potentially the particle flow with the same properties of the seeds and try and model these particles whacking through. And those two things were kind of interesting on their own right, but by combining the impact testing results and the CFD, I could predict the kill. So I could say, in this CFD model, I'm going to hit it five times at 60 metres a second, for example. And this is basically the 100th iteration of different designs. And like at some point, you just have to suck it and go, I'm going to build something. So it's 2012, July, built this mill that looked like this, and you can see the particles zigging through there. So basically the idea was that we'd try and hit these static angular bars that you see on the IHSD these days. So we're trying to hit them square on, and then it would hit a rotating row and hit those square on. So the idea is that like you're really making sure that nothing can escape without getting whacked. Built this machine and did some germination results, and amazingly, the germination results, so this is prediction, and this was the germination results, the blue dots. The prediction and the germination results were almost identical, which was great for my thesis. But the actual key thing was that at 3000 RPM, we were getting 90% kill. So we had something that would kill weeds. And it was 2012, Christmas Eve, we had the first machine. We got a hydraulics company to just drive this thing. We didn't really know how to do it. So took this mill, plugged it on a case 9120. And at Richard Konzag's and ran it down the paddock. And then long story short, I spent 3 years trying to fix hydraulic problems. So this is me in 2012, thinking that I'd figured it all out. Pretty happy with myself. We've got a machine that kills weeds and it can work on a combine. And then I got punched in the face. basically it went out for commercialization, and UniSA were like, oh, we promote entrepreneurship and we want to support researchers to do things, and it was just a load of crap basically. They commercialized it and kept me out of it. It was pretty tough going, really. I guess then I saw that this door shut and another one opened. I had the opportunity to have another go at this. My business partner, Mark Ashton, and I decided one day on some kayaks at Penishore that we'd have another go. And it was all about going, you know what? I have spent 5.5 years designing a mill. And once you've done that for a long time, you actually kind of get stuck in some ruts and some things that you don't like. One of them was hydraulics. So I knew that it needed to be mechanical drive. We're wasting 40% of our power just out the back. The other one is no load power. The no load power of the IHSD is horrendous. And the reason is it's got all these sharp edges that create a lot of turbulence and hot air. So it needed to be aerodynamic. It needed to be able to pass through the wind. Third, it was fragile. It could break easily. And the fourth is that it was relying on impact alone. So dropping in mill speed, which Sam talked about. Moisture content was another one, which I think is critical for this area. Basically, you just lose a lot of kill in those scenarios. So it created the multi-stage hammer mill. This is the machine that we've have been running for quite a few years. We've developed it over time to basically use less power. Mick Schultz was pretty adamant that I was killing it 150%, I think, which I didn't know how to calculate, but I think he was probably right. And we've sort of opened it up. And this, I guess this latest research has made me think, well, you know, where are we? Like, are we killing the small seeds well enough, or should we do some more to go after them? I guess the other part of this story was that, which is relevant here, is that we went really hard early, and we went after all the different colours, way too aggressive with the development cycles, and a lot of my first few years ended up looking like this, just like hopelessly under the machine covered in chaff. I refer to this, I don't know if you've seen this plot before, but it's the knowledge curve here versus expertise. And this curve here is how much I think I know. And as you can see, it peaks. This is how much I actually know, the blue line. And this green one is how much I realise there is to know. And I guess in 2016, I probably sat up here somewhere and it all came crashing down for me. And right now I feel like this study has just demonstrated there's just so much more to learn, even after 14 years of trying to kill as many weeds as possible. There's more to go. So that curve I presented on impact testing was when I saw Sam's results for the power versus kill. I was like, well, this is pretty familiar, this curve. So I actually did some calculations on the predicted kill rates at 2.8 milligrams per seed and 2.1 milligrams per seed. So basically you've got a lighter seed and you try and hit it. It hasn't got a lot of energy in it. It's like hitting a small rock versus a big rock. There's a lot more energy involved in big particles. We've got energy here and we've got kill there. And basically we can see that if you have a heavy seed versus a light seed, you get totally different kill response based on this energy going into it. And previous testing, so we actually did some benchmark testing even earlier against IHSD and Redicop. We put a treadmill inside the combine harvester to get the constant flow rate of chaff and tested all the different mills. And the results were something like this. We had 86% for the Redicop, we had about 96 for the IHSD, and we had 98.7 for the Terminator. And you can see that the Terminator and the IHSD in kill rate with that higher level kill could not be determined, like you couldn't pick that out statistically. But I knew from my own experience that there's a lot more energy going into the seed for a Terminator. And then what happens is if you have a lighter seed, 2.1 here, that you get this drop in kill rate, and all of a sudden you can tell the difference between those seeds. So basically what I think we need to rethink is we need to look at the data that Sam's got on seed size across weeds, across in the actual paddock, and go, where do we want to be on this curve? We've got a few options. The high capacity Terminator is the same as the IHSD. But we need to make sure that we're not thinking about the heavy seed kill rate, or worse, a different species altogether, when we're trying to kill small ryegrass seeds in the paddock. And the next one that's critical for this region, and after spending some time here and talking to people here, I think that we need to investigate it further. The amount of grain drying that happens means that the ryegrass seed has to be higher moisture than what we see in a lot of other areas. So this data here is from my thesis as well. And basically we've got different combinations of impact, and this is impact alone. It works out to every 1% increase in moisture content was a drop in 2.2% kill. Quite a significant drop. So to counteract that, then we need to move this way in order to go after those harder to kill seeds. But we need to look at this further. And if we want to see impact in the paddock, this is critical.